We will continue with the recognition of revenue. SLFR is 15 and we were discussing the 5-step model. We have discussed the fact that to apply the 5-step model, first you need to make sure a contract is existing, and then you need to identify the performance obligations, and then you need to determine the transaction price, and that's where we were finally in the previous video of SLFR 15. The transaction price will comprise of various components like the fixed consideration, variable consideration, and there can be sometimes a significant finance cost, significant finance charge, and there can be sometimes the payments to be made to the customer himself and so on and so forth. So we have started discussing the significant finance component. So I said, for there to be a significant finance component, there has to be kind of a hidden finance arrangement, implicit finance arrangement that's not seen to the naked eye, and you should read between the lines of the scenario to identify whether the arrangement is including a hidden finance arrangement. Then the interest rate, and you can't just take any rate as the interest rate. As we discussed, finally you all have to decide in recognizing the finance income the interest rate in such a way that the credit characteristics of the customers are reflected. So basically what we do is you take the time value of money, and that is adjusted by the credit risk of the customer, and then you can decide and calculate, determine the interest rate to recognize significant finance income, significant finance component. Now let me work out a small question on that. An entity has received an order from a customer and the entity has offered two options. First, to receive ₹1 million now, and to deliver goods in 2 years' time. Second, to receive ₹1 million now, and to deliver goods in 2 years' time. To receive ₹1.5 million in 2 years' time, at the time of the delivery. The customer chose the first option. Incremental borrowing interest rate is 12%. Explain the revenue recognition. Now here what is happening is the exact opposite of what we discussed in the previous illustration. The seller is offering two options to the customer. Either customer can opt to make the payment of 1 million rupees in full right now and can get the delivery of goods in 2 years time. Or the customer can wait over 2 years time and to get the delivery of goods in 2 years time, and at that point the customer can make the full payment of 1.5 million rupees. Now implicit interest rate can be calculated. Now to calculate the implicit interest rate, we can use that formula. We discussed this even in financial instrument. Future value is equal to present value into 1 plus r to the power n. Future value seems to be 1.5 million rupees, whereas the present value is 1 million. 1 plus r to the power n, number of years, 2 years. If you simplify, that seems to be 22.47. Now, as I said before, you can't apply any rate as the interest rate to recognize finance income or finance expenditure here. And this is bit of a different scenario of the customer first receiving cash and then delivering the goods in 2 years time. Here it's not that the customer giving a loan, it's not that the seller giving a loan to the customer here, it's like the seller obtaining a loan from the customer first and then settling the loan in 2 years time by delivering of goods. Now here say 1st January 19, the receipt date of the consideration 1 million rupees. So this is like the seller receiving 1 million rupees worth of a loan from the customer first and settling the loan in 2 years time, 31st December 2020. This loan, does it fall under financial instrument? No. Why? There is a contractual obligation not to deliver cash but to settle the loan by delivering goods. So it does not fall within the definition of a financial liability. So as a result, here it's not like the customer getting a loan from the seller, it's like the seller obtaining a loan from the customer first and then the seller settling the loan in 2 years time in form of delivery of goods. So here the seller has to recognize interest, and here the interest rate has to be decided from the viewpoint of the seller. If the seller takes a loan from a bank of 1 million rupees to settle that in 2 years time, what rate does the bank grant the loan to the seller? That is what you mean by incremental borrowing interest rate. So what would have been the rate at which the bank would grant the loan to the seller and that is 12%. This is the interest rate of the seller, not of the buyer. Why? This is where the seller obtains a loan from the customer first, and then seller settles the loans to the customer in 2 years time by delivery of goods. So here now 22.47 is not the rate to be used. What is the rate to be used? 12%. What is it? Incremental borrowing interest rate of the seller. This is the rate at which the seller would have been granted a loan if the seller applied for a loan from the bank. So let's see how the accounting works here. January 1st 19 on the date of receiving the consideration, you debit cash and bring that not to a revenue account. I can't explain revenue recognition part right now here because we need to complete all the 5 steps in the model to explain that part. Anyway, towards the end of this video, you will be able to understand it. Until the goods get delivered, temporarily you debit to cash account and credit to liability by 1 million rupees. And the value of the liability as of now is 1 million, but you need to keep transferring and transforming this value from 1 million rupees present value to the future value. So you need to go on charging interest at what rate? 12%. So 120,000 debit profit and loss, credit to liability. Why are we debiting profit and loss? It's a finance charge to the seller. It's like the seller obtaining a loan from the customer. Value of the liability becomes 1,120,000 rupees end of the first year. Balance 1,120,000. And will recognize interest to the second year. Second year interest is 134,400. 134,400. 0, 0, 4, this is 4, 5. 1,254,400. Now, the seller is delivering the goods to the customer. As the goods are delivered to the customer, now the seller has to de-recognize liability and to recognize that into revenue. You can debit to liability by 1,254,004 and credit to liability by that term. So that's how it works. another example. What it says is an entity received 1 million rupees on 1st January 19 to deliver two consignments of goods of equal sizes and quantity on 31st December 19 and 31st December 2020. Incremental borrowing interest rate of the seller is 10%. So, 1 million has been received by the seller on this date. And this is the full consideration received in advance for two consignments of goods that are of equal size, equal quantity to be delivered on two different dates. And the first one is due on 31st December 19, second one is due on 31st December 2020. So, since the goods, the two consignments are of two of equal sizes and quantity, let me take the value of the first delivery to be 500,000 and the value of the second delivery to be 500,000. Once again, how you should interpret this particular transaction should not be the way it is literally read. This is like the seller receiving loans first on 1st January 19 and settling the loan in the future by delivery of goods. So, it does not fall in the category of financial liabilities. Why? The contractual obligation is not to delivery of cash, to delivery of goods. Then, these are liabilities, not the financial liabilities. This is the present value or the future value of the liability. Obviously, this is the future value. Once again, this is the future value. Now, the examiner sometimes can load some redundant, unnecessary information in the question by giving the interest rates of the seller, by giving the interest rates of the buyer as well, and sometimes different interest rates of the buyer and the seller will be given at the exam to exactly test whether the students are smart in selecting the appropriate interest rates in the application. Now, once again, you must take the interest rate of the seller. Why did the seller who takes the loans from the customers, and what interest rate do we use from the perspective of the seller? Seller's incremental borrowing interest rate. What does it say? If the seller walked into a bank to apply for a loan of 1 million rupees, partly to be settled in 1 year's time and partly to be settled in 2 years' time, so what would have been the rate at which the bank would grant the loan? It is 10%. So let's calculate the present value. 500,000 is discounted by 1.1. This is discounted by 1.1 to the power 2. Here the present value has to be 454,545. Here the present value is 413,223. How do we do the accounting now? Let me open up two accounts. Say liability. Take the total liability by debiting cash and crediting to liability. You have to take the total present values of both 454,545 plus 413,223. That is 867,768. But the seller has collected 1 million rupees. So the balance is interest 132,232. Debit cash and credit to deferred interest account 132,232. And the first delivery is due in 1 year's time. The revenue should be recognized by derecognizing liabilities only when the goods are delivered to the customer. as promised and agreed in the agreements between the seller and the buyer, the first delivery of the goods was done on 31st December 19, and then the amount to be recognized into revenue is no longer 454,545. The amount of revenue to be recognized in 1 year's time should be 500,000. So as a result, let me recognize interest first. How? You will debit to deferred interest. How much? Interest is debited, deferred interest will be debited by 86,776 and debit to deferred interest by 86,776, credit to liability. Then let's recognize revenue of 500,000 rupees to profit and loss. $954,544. Balance is 454,544. Balance 454,544. 132,232. Take the difference, and that is the balance to be carried forward. That is 45,456. Balance is 45,456. Then we recognize interest to the second year as well. Why? As you deliver the goods end of the second year, the amount to be recognized into revenue should not be any amount but 500,000 rupees. So do we have 500,000 rupees in liability? No. To make it 500,000, you need to first transfer interest to the liability account. Debit to interest and credit to liability by 45,456. So the revenue to be recognized now in the second year should be 500,000 rupees. That's how it works. Now before I wind up on this significant finance matter, remember, not that do we recognize a finance charge every time when the seller defers the receipt of the consideration to the future. Make sure that there is always a hidden or implicit finance arrangement, and then only we can recognize significant finance component. And I said in the previous video, sometimes the consideration can be deferred to the future for reasons other than providing a finance arrangement to the customer. I took an example, let me remind you all. So what I said was, a construction company completed a constructions with a value of 500 million. And the contract provides that the buyer, the customer, has a right of retaining 10% of the total consideration. That is to safeguard and protect the customer. And the customer can hold on to that 10% over 2 years' time from the date of the delivery of the construction to the customer. Why? To make sure that the building is up to the standard, up to the expectation, and if any damages, any defects are found and detected within 2 years' time, that 10% can be made use of to get those mistakes, get those defects corrected without, you know, asking from the seller. Then If the customer does not detect any mistakes in the construction within 2 years time, then that 10% should be returned back to the seller. Now that 10% of the total consideration will be deferred over 2 years time for a reason other than providing a hidden finance arrangement. So as a result, when the seller debits to receivable account, now the total is 500. 500 would have got credited to revenue already and debited to cash account by 450, that is what was collected in cash, and the balance amount 50 million can be debited to receivable account without being discounted. Why does it come to the receivable account without being discounted? Because there is no finance component. Why? There is no hidden finance arrangement. Also, another instance, let me explain. As I said before, seller is receiving the full amount of the consideration in advance, and the seller will be supposed to deliver the goods in 1 year's time. Then this is like the seller receiving a loan first and then settling the loan in 1 year by delivery of goods. So you need to discount. But if it is a situation where the seller receives 1 million rupees from the customer and the seller will keep the goods ready for the customer to collect, but the seller does not know when the customer will collect the goods for him. We do not know. It's up to the customer to come and pick the goods at any time that he wishes. So since we do not know when the customers will come and pick the goods, you cannot recognize any finance income. Why? It's like we keeping the goods ready now. It's like we taking the goods. It's like we taking 1 million rupee considerations in full for the goods to be delivered. And if the goods are not collected by the customer, that is up to him and we can't tell. So you need not to discount 1 million rupees. You can debit cash by 1 million and credit to revenue account when the goods are ready for delivery, and until then you can keep it in the liability account. So we can move on. Variable consideration. Once again, even this part is a lengthy discussion, but let me limit my examples just for one or two for the sake of being within the time constraint, within the given time limit. Now, variable consideration, there can be incentive payments and there can be bonus payments, and sometimes there can be refunds payable back to the customers. Lot of instances are there where the variable considerations will get involved. In whatever the form variable considerations appears in a practical scenario or a questions in the paper at the exam, you can include variable considerations into revenue only when the seller is certain that there will not be reversal of cumulative revenue recognized when uncertainties are resolved in the future. And you need to keep that part in your mind. You can include variable considerations into the recognition of revenue only if the seller is certain that there will not be a reversal of cumulative revenue recognized now when uncertainties are resolved in the future. Let me take a simple example. First January 19, a construction company enters into a contract to construct a storied building. Say the contract price has been 5 million rupees. This is the fixed consideration. The duration of the construction is 5 years. So the construction company has to be strictly within the given time frame. Why? The seller is given another 500,000 incentive payment on the condition of being able to complete the construction exactly within 5 years. Now, say we are in the process of recognizing revenue for the first year, ending 31st December 2019. Now the seller can be in the horns of a dilemma without being able to figure out whether revenue for the first year should be based on 5 million or whether the revenue for the first year should be based on 5.5 million. 5 million is the fixed consideration, 500,000 is variable consideration. Whether we should recognize revenue only out of 5 million or whether we should recognize revenue out of the entire 5.5 million should be decided based on the fact that the seller should be certain that future there will not be a reversal in the future of the revenue recognized now when uncertainties are resolved. Now see, being at the end of the first year, the seller is not at all sure about whether we can finish it within 5 years time or not. Despite of that uncertainty, say 20% of the construction is over by the end of the first year, then 5 million plus 500,000, total 5.5 million, seller recognized revenue of 20% on 5.5 million, so the revenue taken to the first year has been 1.1 million. End of the fourth year, just one more year to go, the seller knows that he can't finish the construction within another 1 year's time. He knows it's not at all possible to complete the construction within 5 years' time, then he will deserve for this variable consideration or will not deserve. Then what has happened? He has to get back to 4 years retrospectively and to start correcting the financial statements for how many years? 4 years time. Why? When uncertainties are resolved, the revenue recognized for the 4 years past cumulative revenue has to be corrected, has to be rectified, and that is what it says. If that happens, there will be some problems in the future. So you must assure that there has to be a guaranteed certainty that the revenue that you recognize need not to be reversed in the future when uncertainties are resolved. Now, the fact whether you can finish the construction within 5 years' time or not depends on how soon you can finish the exterior work of the construction. Why? As the construction rises up, how fast you can finish the work, exterior work, depends on the weather condition. The construction of exterior work of the building is highly susceptible to changes of the weather condition. If the atmosphere is windy, you can't complete exterior work up. If the atmosphere and the weather conditions is like rainy, you can't do it at all. So as a result, the sooner you can complete the exterior work of the construction, the faster we can finish. The faster you can complete the exterior work of the construction, higher the probability of being able to complete the construction within 5 years' time. Now, until the end of the first year, you have not been able to complete the exterior work. Until the end of the second year, you have not been able to complete the exterior work. What does it say? Until such time you complete exterior work, you are not in a position to make sure whether the construction can be completed within 5 years' time or not. So for the first 2 years, you recognize revenue not on 5.5 million, only on 5 million rupees. So as a result, variable consideration should be included to revenue recognition only when the seller can make sure that the revenue that we recognize now will not get reversed in the future when uncertainties are resolved. APLC has sold goods to BPLC and received 10,000 shares of BPLC. The fair value of a share of BPLC was 20 rupees on the date of the delivery. So here the consideration of the goods sold has been settled to the seller, not in cash, it's some other forms, by issuing the equity instruments of the buyer. Very simple, I said at the beginning without discussing a question that there are two aspects to be looked at. You need to recognize revenue on one hand, and also you need to recognize the investment made by A in the shares of company B on the other hand. So for the investments you need to apply SLFRS 9, and for the revenue recognition you should apply SLFRS 15. So you need to decide the measurements of the transactions in such a way the requirements of both transactions are satisfied. What are the measurement requirements? You know, whenever you recognize a financial instruments, irrespective of their classifications, the initial measurement should be fair value. Once again, you need to look at how the revenue should be measured. Then very simple, it's on fair value. It has to be measured at fair value. So which fair value are we to use? It's very simple. We'll take the fair value of the shares of company B. It is how much? 200,000 rupees. 10,000 shares into 20, debit to investment account by 200,000 rupees and credit to revenue by 200,000. Then we'll go to, we'll move on to the fourth step. The fourth step is allocation the transaction price over the performance obligations. And remember, the fourth step is connected to the second step. What is the second step? Identifying the performance obligations. If you got stuck at the second step, you will continue to get stuck at fourth stage and the fifth stage as well. Why the fourth and fifth stages are connected to second stage. Now, I said a seller sells a mobile at 300,000 rupees. Along with the mobile, the seller has agreed to provide services over 12 months period, free services. Device is one and the services is another. The way we learnt at stage number 2, performance obligations, how many performance obligations did you study there were? There were 2 performance obligations. The customer is benefited only from the device alone without receiving the service, because the customer can get the service from someone else. Similar, the customer can be benefited only from the services by getting only the SIM card from the service, this particular seller, and the customer can purchase the device from someone else. Why? We have a market as such, where there are so many people who sell only the devices, where there are so many people who sell only the service. But the fact is that the seller has collected only 300,000 rupees, but there are 2 revenue items to be recognized. And that is what this fourth step has been there for. For the customer, I made a mistake, for the seller to cut and chop this 300,000 rupees to segmental revenue item. How many segments are there? I can't say segments, but kind of a similar meaning. There are 2 items of revenue for which there is a single consideration of 300,000 rupees. So this 300,000 should be distributed over how many performance obligations, how many revenue items? Over 2 revenue items. How do we do it? And that's what we are going to discuss now. Let me tell you another simple example before we go to the detailed discussion. A seller sells a software at 2.5 million rupees to a customer, and what does the seller promise in exchange of 2.5 million rupees? Seller promises the license to the software, seller promises the installation of the software, seller promises the training of the software to the customer, seller promises technical support to the customer, seller promises future upgrades as well to the customer in the future. So before you start allocating 2.5 million rupees over whatever the number of revenue items of the seller, you need to apply the second step, where you should first identify the performance obligations. Now, you know what the license is. The vendor of the software gives us a lengthy number, which is including, which is a mix of both alphabetical letters and digits. Unless you receive the license, that number, digit number, even if the software is installed into the computer, you can't get that to work. Why? Without you entering that license code, it doesn't become operative. even if you get the license, you can't get the software to become operative. Why? It has still not been installed. Never do we get a market where you can get the license from one end vendor and you can get another vendor to install the software. Similarly, never do we get a market where you can get the installation from one vendor and to get the license from another vendor. No. You should get the license only from the very vendor whom you got the installation done. Similarly, you need to get the installation done from the very vendor whom you got the license from. So, as a result, customer does not benefit only from the license without the installation being done. Similarly, the customer is not benefited only from the installations without the license being given. So then license and installation are distinct or are not distinct. Where the license and the installations are not distinct, put them together as a single performance obligation. But if you think of a general nature, not a tailored software, general nature software, so there are many people who only sell the software without giving the training. Or if you are already trained yourself, it might as well to take the software from the vendor and you need not to get the training. So the customer is benefited only from these two without getting the training. Customer will be benefited from these three without getting the technical support. Customer will be benefited only from these four without getting the future upgradation. So what does it say? License plus installation should not be distinct, whereas training, technical and upgradations are distinct from each other. So how many performance obligations are there? Four performance obligations are there. So this 2.5 million should be allocated among how many performance obligations? You need to allocate that 2.5 million rupees over four performance obligations, and that's what we are going to discuss now. So you need to allocate the entire transaction price over the performance obligation using this method. What is it? Standalone prices. Standalone prices. What do you mean by a standalone price? Now say you will join somewhere for lectures of chartered accountants. Say you want to learn ABR. If you only want to learn ABR from a particular place, say they say we are charging 4,000 rupees a month. But if you say I want to learn ABR plus finance management, they say we are not charging 8,000 rupees, then we are charging 7,000 rupees. 7,000 is not the price of a single subject, it's the price of two subjects. It's a package now. Now, for the sake of the customer being motivated to learn two subjects from one place, the seller has offered a significant discount. Now, just because you learn finance management, you decide to learn ABR as well, So the price of ABR was decided, and that is dependent on the price of finance management. So the prices there are not dependently decided. I mean independently decided. Prices have been dependently decided. The price reduction was given for a subject because the other subject was taken. If not for the other subject was taken, you wouldn't have been given that discount. So the prices of 7,000 offered to the customer are not independently decided. They are dependently decided. So then this price is not standalone. If you took only ABR, what would have been the price? That would have been 4,000. So that is what you mean by standalone price. I'm standing alone without leaning against the desk. If I started leaning against the desk, this I'm not standing alone. I get the support from someone else. Now, you should allocate this total contract price over the performance obligation based on what? Based on standalone prices. That is what has to be remembered perfectly. Only one concept is there to allocate the transaction price, that is nothing but standalone prices. But for you to decide that standalone prices, we can make use of different approaches. As you can see for yourself right now, there can be observable price, best evidence, and that is taken from the market. As you decide to allocate the transaction prices over the performance obligation, you need to optimize market information. The more market information you will resort to, more accurate your information will be. The less market information you resort to in allocating the transaction price, less accurate your information will become too. To make more accurate your information, you need to optimize as much as you can. You need to make use of market information. So if the market standalone prices are not available, then only you start sliding down in this sequence. Adjusted market assessment approach, expected cost plus margin residual approach. So let me work out a simple example and we'll move on. A seller sells a mobile and services over 12 months period for rupees 300,000. Market prices mobile 240,000 rupees, service 10,000 rupees per month, and how many months? 12 months altogether 120,000. Unless the seller offered this package to the customer, customer would obviously purchase the mobile separately and the service separately, and then the transactions would have been standalone. And these prices are what? Market prices. I am starting where I am supposed to start from. I am starting from what the standard considers the best is from. Market information. So these are standalone, best evidence. What do you mean by best evidence? Always, every time wherever possible, you need to start from the best information, best evidence of taking information from the market. So that's what I did. Now, the total would have been 360,000. But the customer gets it at now 300,000 rupees. So there is a discount of 60,000. Here, not only does the seller allocate the price of 300 over the mobile and the services, also the seller allocates the discount as well. So both of them happen. What I will do is 300,000 is divided by 360,000. $240 divided by 360 into 300,000. $120,000 divided by 360 into 300,000. $240 divided by 360 into 300. So this is 200,000. 120 divided by 360 into 300. This is 100,000. So the seller offers the mobile at 200,000 rupees, which is normally sold at 300,000. The services are offered to the customer at 100,000 rupees, which is normally sold at 120. I made a mistake. The mobile has been given to the customer, which is normally sold at 240. Services are offered to the customer, which are normally sold at 120. The discount allocated to the mobile is 40,000. Discount allocated to the services are 20,000. I said we are doing two things at the same time. Not only does the seller allocate the contract price, also the seller allocates the discount as well. So both happen at the same time. Now let me go to the other areas as well. A seller sold a software at rupees 3 million. Seller promises license, installation, training, technical support, and upgradation. Market price of the software alone is rupees 1.8 million. Adjusted market price of training is rupees 600,000. Number of hours 4. Technical support 40 hours, the cost of an hour 5,000, so we'll make it a 5,000, and 40% markup. So that is 5,000 into 40. $200 will add the markup, so that will be 280,000. So this is the information given. Now, what is the seller charging 3 million rupees for? That is to install the software, to provide the training, to provide technical support, and then to also provide upgradation. What if the customer purchased only the software without getting the training, without getting the technical support, and without getting the upgradations in the future? Then the vendor would have charged only 1.8 million rupees. That is the market price. So where am I? I am at the top of the sequence. I am where I am supposed to be. I have to optimize market information in allocating. Right. What if the buyer takes the installation and takes the training as well? Now it's like this. Adjusted market price. What do you mean by adjusted market price? Sometimes you can't decide the market price of a particular service or particular good on its own. So what you can do is you will take the selling price, market price of a similar item, and you derive the selling price of the item concerned by adjusting the price of the similar item. Now say for a small example, somebody who wants to initiate doing chartered wants to follow classes starting from business level, say BL1. We'll assume that no one is doing classes for BL1, why it is almost similar to A-level class. So one particular student who has never done accountancy in life wants to start from BL1. Now, since no one is doing classes for BL1, so nobody knows how much of class fees to be charged for BL1. But we all know CL2 is the improved version of BL1. And there are so many suppliers in the market to conduct classes for CL2. CL2 is not identical to BL1, but there are similarities. And if a tuition provider is charging 3,000 rupees for CL2, improved version of BL1, we will do a discount for the simplicity of BL1 and decided to charge like something like 2,000. This is not in the market, but this is what is in the market. This is not the price of an identical subject. This is the price of a similar subject. So what you did was, 2,000 was derived by discounting or by deducting something, by making an allowance of 3,000 rupee market price for the simplicity of the subject BL1. So this is adjusted market price. Market price of a similar product was taken and you made an allowance for the simplicity, for the nature of simplicity of BL1. So that is called what? Adjusted market assessment approach. Then, what if the buyer decides to take the installation, decides to take the training, and decides to take the technical support as well? For the technical support, there is no market price at all, we'll assume. There is not even a similar product from which the market price to be derived of the product concern. then you will slide further down in the sequence, you will take expected cost plus margin. And where nothing is possible, we are going to the worst and the least important one, residual approach, and let me work it out now. A standalone market price is 1.8 million rupees, and that is what gets allocated to the software. Adjusted market assessment approach is how much? 600,000 rupees. So that's what you allocate to training. And for the technical support, how many hours to be devoted? 40 hours. And what is the cost to be incurred for a single hour? 5,000. 5,000 into 40 is the total cost, 200,000. But we are charging a profit markup as well. How much is it? 40%. Then how much do we need to allocate to a technical support to it? Let's take the total. This is 1.8, 2.4. And 2,680,000 gets allocated to first three. Out of 3 million, 2,680,000 got allocated to first three. What is the balance remaining? Is 320, and that remaining balance gets allocated to what? Last item, that is upgradation, and that is what you mean by residual approach. Now let's look at another contrasting example. So there are three products A, B, C. Standalone selling prices are given. A standalone selling price, market price is A 40, B 55, C 45, total is 140. The entity regularly sells B and C at 40. Now, the entity enters into a contract to sell A, B and C at rupees 100. Now, as I said before, in this process of allocating the contract price over performance obligation, you not only allocate the transaction price to performance obligations, also you allocate what? Discount. If you sell separately A, B, C, what is the total? 140. Now, if you sell the bundle, what is the price? 100. So what is the discount? Discount has to be 40. Now, sometimes discount allocation can be little different from the allocation of the contract price. Here it says entity regularly sells B and C at 60. And that is the practice of the seller. And that is the practice in the market as well. So if you want to optimize market information, you need to take some additional facts into account. The standard SLFR is 15 requires us to optimize market information, market data. For you to optimize market data, market information, then you can allocate discount only for B and C, not to A. Why? A is sold separately always and B and C get sold together. Out of 100, I will first allocate 40 to A. Why you cannot allocate the discount to A? We don't see a discount being offered to A. Why? A gets sold always separately in separate transactions. Out of 100, 40 got allocated to A and the balance 60 should be allocated to B and C based on standalone prices B and C. B. Then the balance amount is 60. 55 divided by 100 into 60 C, 45 divided by 100 into 60. Let's work it out. 55 divided by 100 into 60. So we will allocate 33 to B. 45 divided by 100 into 60, we will allocate 27 to C. And this is how it works now. So the examiner can set examples and questions of this nature at the exam. So there are lot of areas to be discussed, but we can't go into all those details. We are supposed to be within the time constraint. So let me move on. We'll go to the fifth step now. Recognizing revenue. And however much you are good at the first four stages, unless you know the last step of revenue, recognizing revenue, what you did at the first steps are of no use. Well, this is the end part of it, the most important item, but this is once again connected to the second step. So you'd have noticed now the second step of identifying performance obligations are connected to the fourth step and also to the fifth step. So if you messed up the second and if you are not happy about the second, you need to revisit that area and come back to the fifth step. That's my advice. Revenue is recognized when performance obligations are satisfied. Satisfied. Now, what did I explain the performance obligations were? Enforceable promise. In other words, what does the seller receive the consideration for? Which promise does the seller receive the consideration for? If the seller is receiving the consideration for the purpose for the promise of selling a lunch packet, the price of the lunch packet should be taken to revenue only when the lunch packet is delivered. If the seller is receiving the consideration for the delivery of a bouquet of roses to the crush of a boy, the seller can bring that amount into revenue only when the roses are delivered to the crush of the boy. And if the seller is receiving the consideration for explaining SLFR is 15, the seller can bring that amount to revenue only when you complete explaining performance obligations. That's the end part of SLFR is 50. And if you receive the consideration for the sale of a mobile plus 12 month services, revenue attributable for the phone can be taken to revenue when the phone gets delivered to the customer. And the revenue attributable for the services over 12 months time should be taken to revenue in bits and pieces as and when the customer consumes the services over 12 months time. And if the customer receives the considerations for putting up a constructions which takes minimum 5 years, and then that revenue has to be recognized how this building is put up and the way the building is put up as the building construction progresses, revenue can be recognized. And if the seller receives the consideration for providing accountancy services, you should recognize as the services are provided. And if the revenue or the consideration was received by the seller for filing the tax returns, you need to recognize revenue when you complete filing the tax returns, so on and so forth. There can be enough examples. Revenue should be recognized when the performance obligations are satisfied. How can you satisfy yourself that the performance obligations are satisfied? That's not an easy thing. But we'll try to make it easy. Performance obligations are considered to be satisfied when it comes to goods, when the control of the goods passes to the customer. When it comes to services, when the services are consumed by the customer. When the services are consumed by the customer. And how do we know that the control of the goods passes to the customer? Lot of indications are there. Lot of indications are there. What are these indications? The customer receiving the physical possession of the goods. Customer receiving the physical possession of the goods. Customer becoming liable for the payment. Customer becoming liable for the payment. Customer receiving the legal title. Receiving the legal title of the goods. And the customer receiving the risks and rewards of the goods. Sometimes just one indication may be enough. Sometimes just one indications may not be enough, and you need to take all the indications together. Lot of examples can be given, but still I have to limit my examples and illustrations. Simply, we'll say that a customer wants to buy an air conditioner machine. He walks into a showroom of a particular vendor and the price say 120,000 rupees. Normally, when nothing else is given as explanations in the question, the control of the goods sold to the customer is considered to transfer to the customer when the customer gets the legal title normally, but there can be deviations. So the customer makes the full payment of 120,000 rupees, the invoice was raised, and the air conditioner machine was given to the customer. But the seller is a very loyal seller to the customers. He says, "Sir, please leave it with us and go. Let us have your address. We will get it delivered to your residence and we will fix it also for your sake." Now, at the same time, see, all of these conditions are satisfying. Now, the customer makes the payment. The customer gets the invoice, that is like the customer getting the legal title. And as soon as the customer made the payment, he got the AC machine, he is holding on his hands now. And he got the legal title, he is holding on the hands now. And if it is too heavy to hold on the hands, if the customer just drop it on the ground and his AC machines will broke open into two pieces, who has to bear up the loss? It's not the seller who has to bear up the loss. It's the buyer who has to bear up the loss. Why? What does it say? Risks and rewards have been transferred. And the moment the customer purchased the AC machine, there was a quick sudden change in the climate and that started raining, downpour of rain. Plus, we started getting the winter season. The customer cannot make use of the AC machine, that will be keeping idle. Idle of assets is a risk, and who has to bear up the risk? The customer. Risks and rewards have been transferred. So when it is hot, he wants it cool. When it is cold, he wants it hot. When it is hot, he wants it cool. Always man is what there is not. Similarly, now the customer is getting the risks and rewards of the goods. All the requirements were satisfying at the same time. Now 120,000 can be taken to revenue instantaneously. I have utilized all the conditions and criteria to satisfy, to see the point at which the revenue should be recognized. Now let me take a contrasting example. A is a manufacturer of vehicles. A is sending vehicles to B on sale or return basis. That is 3 months' time. If possible, do the sale within 3 months, and if you can't sell it within 3 months, you have no option but to return the goods back to us. Now, B is receiving the goods physically on 1st January 19. Physical possession of the goods were given. But that alone is not enough here. Why? Just because this customer or the agent got the physical possession, he does not become liable for the payment to the manufacturer A. Why? He becomes liable for the payment only when he sells the vehicles to someone outside. Just because he get the physical possession, he does not become liable for the payment. And just because he gets the physical possession, he does not get the legal title either. And see, one particular customer was to go on a test drive. And the vehicles are with B now. So the customer is now accelerating to check the efficiency of the vehicle. And suddenly he applies brakes. And the brakes becomes operative after 3 hours time from applying, from the time of applying brake. Now you can imagine the rest of the fate of the customer when brakes become operative after 3 hours from the time of operating brakes. So the vehicles are technically defective. Does anyone buy? Nobody buys. And if the goods cannot be sold, does B hold on to goods all along? No. B has to return the goods back to the manufacturer. What does it say? If there are risks, B will take over, will not take over, will not take over. Then immediately B has to return, and as a result A, until B sells the goods, A continues to hold on risks and rewards. A continues to hold on the legal title. A continues to hold everything, and B does not become liable for the payment. B does not get the legal title. B does not get risks and rewards, despite of the fact that B only gets the physical possession. So as a result, just by giving the goods physically to B, A cannot recognize revenue on 1st January. A has to wait to B to sell the goods to another party, and the revenue for A is derived on the event of B selling the goods to an outside party. What I'm saying is, just one criteria being satisfied will not be adequate for you to identify the point at which revenue should be recognized. Now let me take another simple but a contrasting example. A is a manufacturer of vehicles, and he is consigning goods on 1st January 90. A has given 6 months period to B to sell the goods. If the goods are not sold within 6 months period, before the expiry of 6 months, B has to return them to A. And if 6 months period expires, the goods are considered to have been sold by B. Now, A says, on 1st January 19, B has to pay 10% of the total price as an advance payment, and that 10% advance payment will be forfeited in the event of the goods being returned to A. Barriers now. And if B decides to return the goods, it is B who has to take care of transportation and insurance of the goods. If B decides to return the goods, transportation and insurance cost has to be taken over by B. As long as B continues to hold on to the goods vehicles, B has to pay 10% of the price of the vehicles as a display charge. Display charge. The longer the holding period, the bigger the payment of display charge from B to A. And now, if the vehicles are sent on 1st January 19, if the total value is 100 million rupees on the date of the dispatch, A will not accept any decreases in prices. Ups all right, no problem, but even if the market prices will drop within 6 months' time, A will not accept anything below 100 million. B has to remit minimum 100 million rupees, that is the price at the time of the dispatch of goods to B, and these are the conditions now. So you can't just stick to a principle here. Your mind should be open-ended. Keep your mind free. can take the criteria one by one and evaluate them. These conditions in the agreement between A and B are favorable to B or are not favorable. Those conditions would have been included for the purpose of motivating B from returning or from discouraging B from returning. Those conditions are included to discourage B from returning the goods. B knows if the goods are returned, I am losing 10% of 100 million rupees, there itself the loss is 10 million. If I start returning the goods, I have to take care of insurance and transport another loss. If I hold on to goods and then return, I am losing display charges. Now, if you evaluate precisely the chances of B of sending and returning the goods are very low. You can also check the past records. And if say decides B not to return, why? The loss on return of the goods will be massive and infinite and endless. Might as well to keep and sell at whatever the possible price. A knows if the goods are collected by B on this date, A never gets the goods back. All these preventive measures are to prevent B from returning the goods. It's like B getting the physical possession of the goods on 1st January 19, getting the risks and rewards of the goods on 1st January 19, getting the legal title on 1st January 19. So A should recognize revenue at which point on 1st January 19. So see, same arrangement but different terms and conditions. The terms and conditions being different will change the point at which the seller should recognize revenue. Very interesting. Let's see another different arrangement, sale with a repurchase contract. A is the seller, B is the buyer. A sells the goods at 5 million rupees and there's a repurchase contract. It's not optional. The seller has to repurchase the goods whether he likes or not. That is in 2 years' time. And repurchase price will be 6 million rupees. Now what you should read between the lines and should understand, it's not what the question literally reads. What the question literally reads, A sold the goods to B at 5 million rupees with a repurchase contract and there is a repurchase price of 6 million rupees. So that's what it is given literally. But you being a person who is smart now in SLFR is 15 should look at the question with open mind set and to interpret that differently to bring about the reality of the transaction. The reality of the transaction is hidden under some decorated language and terms. Now, since B has has to return the goods in 2 years' time, B gets the physical possession of the goods temporarily for 2 years' time. Since B gets the goods for 2 years' time, he has to return them in 2 years' time, he gets the legal title temporarily. Since he has to return the goods in 2 years' time, never does the customer get the risks and rewards. I'll tell you why. And if the repurchase price is 6 million rupees in 2 years' time, if the market price is 10 million rupees at that time, A will get the benefit of 4 million. The benefit is to the seller. And if the market price is down up to 1 million rupees in 2 years' time, still A has to pay 6 million to repurchase and the loss is to the seller. Risks and rewards never pass. Customer never gets the legal title permanently. Customer never gets the physical possession permanently. All what he gets are for a temporary period. So as a result, if the customer never gets the physical possession, if the customer never gets the legal title permanently, if the customer never gets the risks and rewards permanently, there is no permanent revenue recognition. You can't recognize revenue. Why control does not pass? How do we know the control does not pass? None of the conditions, none of the criteria is satisfied. So there is no sale at all. So what is it? If it is a sale legally with a repurchase contract, and if the repurchase price is higher than the original selling price, that has to be a finance arrangement. Finance arrangement. If it is a sale with a repurchase contract and the repurchase price is higher than the original selling price, let it to be a finance arrangement, and A cannot recognize revenue. Instead, the proceeds which A received should be recognized into a liability. This is a financial liability now. SLFR is 9 applies. What if the repurchase price will be lower than original selling price? A promises to repurchase the asset in 2 years' time at 4 million rupees, not at 6 now. Repurchase price is lower than original selling price. Then this is not a finance arrangement either. What is it then? A has taken 5 million rupees by giving the asset to B for the use of 2 years' time temporarily. And by returning the asset back to the owner, B need to refund 4 million rupees for A. So that is like A giving the control of the use of the asset to B over 2 years' time for a payment of 1 million rupees. So what characteristics does this arrangement include now? It's not a sale, it's not a finance arrangement either. What is it? It is a lease agreement now, so you need to apply SLFR 16. Sale with a call option. 5 million was the original selling price. And exercise price, if the seller decides to repurchase, he has to pay 6 million rupees. Since the repurchase is not mandatory here, you need to first assess how probable is the seller of repurchasing. That depends on what the expected market values will be in the future. If the future market price will be 8 million rupees, or if the future market price is expected to be 3 million rupees, let's see how the accounting should be. Right. if the market price in the future is 8 million rupees, exercise price is 6 million, seller has to refund only 6 million, so the seller will be benefited. To get the benefit back, he will obviously repurchase. If the seller repurchases, he has to refund 6 million. Then once again, it is similar to a repurchase agreement. Then see, repurchase price and compare that with the original selling price, since it is higher. And once again, this is accounted as a finance arrangement. There is no sale. Say the repurchase price is now 4 million rupees, but the expected market price will be 8 million rupees. Since the expected price in the market is higher than the exercise price, it's benefited to the seller. Seller will obviously repurchase, but what the seller is supposed to return is only just 4 million rupees, not 5 million original selling price. Now this arrangement is something similar to a lease arrangement in SLFR 60. Let's take the other way. Exercise price is 6 million rupees, and future price in the market is expected to be 3 million rupees. Seller can decide whether to buy or not to buy. So what do you think he will do? He will decide to buy or not to buy. He will decide not to buy. Why? Purchasing at 6 million rupees is absolutely useless when the market price is 3 million. So without buying, he just let the buyer to keep the asset for him. The seller will let the call option to expire. Then the buyer will get the total asset for him. He gets the legal title, he gets the risks, he gets the physical possession. Now the sale is complete. Now only you can bring this 5 million rupees to revenue. And we'll take the same thing under a put option. Original selling price is 5 million. Exercise price is 6 million rupees. We will expect the market price to be 8 million rupees. Then again, we'll assume the future market price to be 3 million rupees. And let's see how the seller should recognize it now. It can be a sale, it can be a finance arrangement, or it can be a lease arrangement. Let's see what it will be like. Exercise price is 6 million. Now the market price will be 8 million rupees. Now you need to look at it from the buyer's viewpoint. What do you think the buyer will do? He will decide to keep it forever. He will decide to return it to the seller. The buyer will decide not to return. If he returns, he gets only 6 million rupees. If he waits without returning, he can sell it to someone in the market at 8 million rupees. So the buyer will get the benefit. It's the buyer who decides whether to keep or whether to return. Since the buyer does not decide to return it to the seller, the buyer will keep the asset. Now, seller should recognize revenue. 5 million should be taken to revenue account. And say, expected market price is 3 million. Buyer knows if he returns the asset back to the seller, he gets 6 million rupees. Then returning is more preferable than keeping. Now the buyer decides to return, so the seller gets it back. Then when the seller gets it back, he has to return 6 million. Now it is again looking like a finance arrangement. Finance arrangement. Let's say expected market price is 3 million rupees and the seller has to return only 4 million rupees. Now what is it looking like? Since the expected market price of the asset is 3 million and the seller has to return only 4 million rupees, it's lower than original selling price. Exercise price is lower than original selling price. Again, this is looking like a lease arrangement. Lease arrangement. Right. So in a call option and a put option, you need to compare the exercise price with the future market prices to assess how probable the options been exercised. And thereafter, you need to compare exercise price and the selling price to understand whether it is a sale, whether it is a finance arrangement, or whether it is a lease arrangement. Now, in recognizing revenue, I said performance obligations. Need to be satisfied. Control of the goods should pass to the buyer. Control passes in two ways, either at a particular point in time. Or the control without being given to the customer at once may transfer to the customer over a period. So what we finished discussing right now is this one, transferring the control at a particular point in time. And there were indications like what, giving the physical possession, making the customer liable for the payment and giving the legal title and transferring risk and rewards. Where the control of the goods passes to the customer over a period, there are some criteria once again that we need to look at. There are three, and let's take one by one with illustrations and examples. First one, it says performance obligations are either satisfied over time or at a particular point in time. Satisfied over time if one of the following criteria is met. The entity creates or enhances an asset that the customer controls as it is created or enhanced. Second, the entity's performance does not create an asset with alternative use, and the entity has a right to payment for performance completed to date. The customer simultaneously receives and consumes the benefits of the entity's performances as the entity performs. The first one, an entity creates or enhances an asset that the customer controls as it is created, as it is enhanced. As the asset is created or enhanced. Now, company A is a construction company and enters into a contract with a customer B. What is it for? Company B is contracting with company A to get a house built on a land that belongs to the seller. The land on which the house is going to stand belongs to the seller. Now, who is controlling the land? Seller himself is controlling the land. Does the customer get the access to the ongoing construction of the house without taking the permission of the seller before the construction was completed? No. Even for the customer to see the progress of the construction, to get the access, the customer has to speak to the seller and to get the access. But let me change it now. B will contract with the seller A to get a house constructed on a land that belongs to the customer. The house that is going to stand on a land which is belonging to the customer, not to the seller. Who is controlling the land now? It is the customer who is controlling the land. Now, even for the seller to initiate the construction, who has to take the permission? To get the access to the property, who has to get the permission? Now, seller has to get the permission from the customer. And if the seller during the first week complete laying the foundation, who will control the completed work? It's not the seller who controls the work completed. It's the instantaneously, as and when it is done, the customer gets the control of the foundation done. Next week, for the seller to continue with the construction, seller has to come in the morning to get the permission to get the access to the property. Why? It is a land that belongs to whom? Belongs to the customer. So each and every single bit of construction that the seller completes day to day basis goes to the customer, and the customer starts controlling. The walls were constructed, customer gets the control. The roof was constructed and the customer gets the control. The plastering was done, the customer gets the control. So, does the customer get the control of the asset when the construction is fully done? No. Gradually, as the asset is created, gradually as the asset is constructed, then and there, as and when the construction progresses, the customer gets the control. Why? Because it's a land where the building is standing belongs to the customer, not to the seller. So every single bit of construction the seller performs, the customer gets the control then and there, instantaneously. So as a result here, the control passes to the customer over the period. If the construction will be over 2 years' time, the control passes to the customer over 2 years' time. And as a result, seller should recognize revenue not at a particular point in time. Seller should recognize revenue over 2 years' construction period. Second, the entity's performance does not create an asset with alternative use, and the entity has a right to payment for performance completed today. So there are 2 points to be taken account of. Entity's performance does not create an asset with alternative use. And second one, the entity has a right to payment for performance completed to date. Construction company A enters into a contract with B. And B enters into a contract to get a construction done. And this construction of the building is looking like the shape of the planetary. You would have seen to, gone to planetary at some point in your life. I have been there once. Just if you can just visualize how this planetarium looks. Have you ever seen any other building which is looking like the building of the planetarium? No. It's quite tailored to the exact requirements of the customer. It is highly specifically designed only to suit the requirements of the customer. Now, If the seller enters into a contract with a customer to construct an asset which is looking so peculiar and strange, what if the customer refuses to take over the construction later? Can the seller sell it to another party? No. Can the seller start using it on its own? Not at all. What does it say? What if the customer decides not to take over the building? Then seller neither can sell it to another party, nor can he start using on its own. What does it say? The seller has an alternate use to the asset, though does not have an alternate use. On the other hand, now the seller says, look here, I need to protect myself. Later, if you at the end of the construction, if you decide not to take over the construction, I am in a problem. I can't use it for myself, neither can I sell it to someone. No one prefers to buy. So we will mark milestones in the construction, milestones, important junctures in the construction, completing the foundation, putting up the walls and constructing the wall and plastering it and doing plumbing and electrical wiring and then the finishing. Important points, critical points, important junctures are the milestones. After completing the foundation, unless you pay me for the work I have completed, then and there, I will not continue and progress with the balance part of the construction. And then I will complete putting up the walls around, unless you pay me for the work completed, I will not start constructing the balance part, I will not proceed with the balance part. So whenever each milestone is complete and done, customer is supposed to reimburse, customer is supposed to pay for the seller. Now, customer, or rather seller, never keeps the right to take over the asset in settlement of what the customer has to pay to the seller. Instead, the seller will keep only the right to the payment. Why? The seller does not have an alternate use to the asset, meaning seller cannot use it on its own, neither can the seller sell it to another part. Now, say A enters into a contract with a customer to construct a highly tailored machine to company B, highly tailored, and it is customized to the exact requirement and specification of B. What does it say? Other than B using the asset for himself, A cannot use it on its own, A cannot sell it to another party either. Highly specific. But A says, look, unless you pay me at the specified milestones, I will take over the asset. The seller is going to take over the asset. Then the control is not considered to transfer to the customer over the period. Why? Two requirements are needed there. The asset not having an alternate use to the seller is one, and the seller being entitled only to the payment without being entitled to the asset. Just imagine, if you were the seller, why would you keep the right to acquire the asset? Because either you can use it for yourself or you can sell it to someone else. You keeping the right to repossess the asset for you indicates the fact that you have an alternate use to the asset. You, without keeping the right to acquire the asset, will retain the right of receiving only the payment of the work done, indicates the fact that you do not have an alternate use to the asset. You can use it for yourself, or you can sell it to another party either. So both requirements are needed. Then, the customer simultaneously receives and consumes the benefit of the asset. Now say we are in a physical class. We are conducting the class over 6 months' time for ABR. And we are charging the full amount, say 20,000 rupees at the beginning. Without charging monthly class fees, we are charging 20,000 rupees. Now you need to decide 20,000 rupees should be taken to revenue at a particular point in time. It can be at the beginning, it can be at the middle of the term, or it can be at the end of the term, at a particular specific point. Or it should be sliced into 6 pieces and to bring it to revenue over 6 months' time. Your decision is to whether to bring that revenue at one particular point in time or to recognize over the period. Right, so let me apply the three criteria. I am at the last one. Now, in a normal physical class, what happens is the customer receives and consumes the service as the services are provided. Say I am teaching SLFR is 9, at the same time you are learning SLFR is 9. I am teaching SLFR is 15, you are consuming and learning SLFR is 15 at the same time. The customer consumes the service as the services are provided. So now, services are provided, considered to be provided not at a particular point in time. Services are considered to be provided over the entire 6 months period. So without bringing this 20,000 to revenue at a particular point in time, so you need to slice it to 6 pieces and to start bringing that 20,000 over 6 months period without recognizing it at a particular point in time. Just say, without me teaching in a physical class, I am teaching to a device, a gadget, to a camera, and all what I teach will be taken to a CD, and the CD will be sold to the student. Now see, does the customer consume the service as the services are provided? No. I am providing my service at one point and the customer consumes the service at a different point. So then you need to recognize revenue in the second scenario when the CD is sold to the customer. But here in a normal physical class with 100% eye to eye, direct interaction, I am rendering my service then and there the customer receives the service. So the services are consumed by the customers not at a particular point in time over the period. Say APLC is a janitor, provides cleaning services, and enters into a contract with a customer over 3 years period. The customer requires the cleaning service once a week. On every Fridays after office hours, they have to go and clean it. So how many services are to be provided? 52 for a year. Into 3 years, 156 services. How many performance obligations? It is a series of distinct services that are substantially the same pattern of transfer, one single performance obligation. And how are the services considered to be provided? at a particular point in time or over the period. It's over the period. How do we know? The customer consumes the services as the services are provided. Can you keep the services first provided for the customer to consume the services later? Looks funny. It doesn't happen anywhere under the sun. For a service like this cleaning services, what happens is you need to provide the service of cleaning right at the time of providing the services instantaneously. Then and there the customer consumes the services. So then services are considered to be provided over the entire 3 years period. Over the entire 3 years period. Then let's think of another example. A girl enters into a contract with a construction company to get a house constructed, And this girl is looking little different, even the house is looking little different. And the house is almost consisting of so many parts, and the girl says, I want the kitchen to be first constructed. Not the visiting area, I want the kitchen to be first constructed. After office, I can straight away come to the kitchen, start cooking once and for all, even without having a wash and a change. So then the construction company first complete the construction of the kitchen. And soon after completing the kitchen, she comes and settles down in the kitchen by taking all the pots and pans. She is now in the kitchen. Then she says, I want my master bedroom to be completed. Then the construction company proceeded to construct the master bedroom. She took all her furniture, almirah and the beds, and she came and settled down in that room. She is now consuming the room as well. Then she says, I want the visiting area to be completed for my visitors to come and stay there, over there. Now see, it's not that the customer is getting the control of the entire house by and large at one particular point in time. And this house is completed on piecemeal basis. From time to time, each component is completed. As and when each component is completed, the customer starts using, consuming. Then the house is considered to be constructed and completed at a particular point in time or over the period. It's over the period. So those are the three criteria to use to realize the point at which the revenue should be recognized. It can be at a particular point in time revenue recognition, or it can be revenue recognition over the period. So basically, that's the framework of SLFRS 15. And this is not even 40% of the total standard. Lot of other small nooks and corners are there to be dived into, but it's not so practical. I mean, it's not so possible to look into all these areas within the given time frame. And if you understand this basic framework, you yourself can understand the rest of the standard. Now, let me take another important area. It's the modification of a contract. Contract modification. Modification of a contract. modification of a contract, so you need to keep raising up a couple of questions, a questionnaire. Yes. Are the goods in the modification distinct? Yes. Are the prices of the goods in the contract modification reflect standalone prices? Yes. Contract modification is a new contract. And that is your vertical evaluation. And then horizontal evaluations are also there. Modification of a contract, yes. Are the goods in the contract modification distinct? No. Modification is an extension of the existing contract. Modification of a contract, yes. Are the goods in the modification distinct? Yes. Are the prices of the goods in the contract modification reflect standalone prices? No. Modification is a cancellation of the previous and creating a new contract. Right. So once again, you need to bring forward the memories of the second step where you learned identifying performance obligations. Now, to explain this entire thing, let me take a single illustration and then go to a question. Reporting date is on 31st December 19. Company A has been a vendor of computers. 1st July 19, A receives a purchase order from a customer. Say the customer is B to deliver 50 computers, and A is quoting the price of a computer at 100,000 rupees. Right. Purchase order. Of this 50 computers ordered, seller has delivered 20 and another 30 is due for delivery. And before completing the delivery of that 30, customer B places another purchase order asking 40 computers. 30 plus 40, the balance to be delivered now is 70. Right. Now the facts are enough, some other facts are needed, so let's take them case by case. For a contract to be a contract modification, remember that's important, make it a permanent fixture in your memory. Don't let it to fade. When there are changes in the physical quantity. So you must always see whether when you do certain amendments, when you do alterations to the contracts, whether it's resulting in you having a change in the quantity. If there's a change in quantity, then we recognize it as a contract modification. So that is the very first question to raise. So you need to question yourself, are there alterations to the quantity in the contract agreed years? Then you can start sliding down in our diagram. There's a contract modification. Are the goods in the contract modification distinct? To identify this concept of distinctiveness, you need to re-watch our videos on step number 2. So I can't explain it again, you can re-watch. Now we'll concentrate on the second purchase order where the customer ordered another 40. Can the customer benefit only from the 50 computers without the customer buying the second 40 from the same supplier? Yes. In the market, you get as many computer suppliers as you need. And if you want to buy 90 computers from 90 suppliers, even that is possible. So the customer is benefited from the 50 computers without the customer receiving the second 40. Now what does it say? The 42nd computer purchase or the second 40 computers are distinct from the first 50. Goods are distinct. Yes. Now, The price that the supplier quoted for a computer in the first purchase order was 100,000. The market conditions keep changing. Prices keep improving and prices keep decreasing, and that's the market conditions. By the time the customer placed the second purchase order, market price of a computer has slightly come down to 90,000, just a 10% reduction. That is the market price. And for a computer in the second purchase, so the supplier quoted 90, the price quoted by the supplier for a computer in the second purchase order is independent from the fact that the customer purchased 50 bulk in the first purchase order. What I'm asking is, has the price quoted by the supplier in the second purchase order been affected by the purchase in the first purchase order? Not affected. It was not taken into account. As a result, the price of a computer for the second purchase order was dependently decided, determined, or independently determined. Independently determined. Prices of the goods in the contract modification reflect standalone prices. So this is where we will end up at. Second purchase order placed prior before completing delivery, all 50 in the first purchase order is considered to be a new contract. So there are two contracts, old where the customer ordered 50 computers, the new where the customer ordered 40 computers. So based on where you can keep position yourself in the diagram, your final revenue recognition can be different. Now let's go to the beginning again with some changes in the facts. Now same reporting date 31st December 2019, and the customer placed the first purchase order on 1st July 2019 asking 50, supplier quoted 100,000, 20 were delivered, another 30 is due. So before the delivery of the balance 30, customer places another purchase order for 40 computers. Market price is now 90,000 per computer. But, you know, sometimes there are certain words that never go together. You can't say cool fire. It never happens. You can never say business ethics. Whoever who runs a business will never be ethical. You will never say a good girl. I'm just kidding. Here, even though these two concepts of business and ethics never go together, this particular businessman has been a smart and a decent business guy. He thinks of being little generous to the customer. He appreciates him being a customer in the business, and they have been rubbing shoulders for a long time, them being the sellers and the buyers. He thinks, look, I started dealing with this customer 10 years back. Why shouldn't I appreciate his relationship with us? Since he already purchased 50 few days back, I should not sell the second 40 at the same price. I should surprise him by giving a small discount. And he quoted not the market price of 90 itself. He quoted how much now? 80,000. What makes the seller bring down the price, market price 90 to 80,000? The previous purchase of 50. So as a result, the prices in the second purchase order are dependently determined or independently determined. let's go to the chart and start coming from the beginning. Is it a contract modification? You need to question yourself. Here's why there are changes to the volume quantity. Then are the goods distinct in the modification? Yes, customer is benefited only from the first 50 without buying the second 40. They are distinct. More importantly, now question yourself, are the prices of the goods in the contract modification stand alone? Not at all. Why? Market price of a computer was 90. Now the price at which the customer gets the computers in the second purchase order is 80,000. The prices were dependently determined and the previous bulk purchase has been taken into account by the seller in setting the price for the second purchase order. So we are not sliding down now vertically, and this is we are heading to now. Since the prices are not standalone prices, it is like now tearing the previous purchase order into tatters. Out of the previous purchase order, 20 has got delivered already, the balance 30 is due. So that's like you tearing the purchase order into tatters now and merging the balance from the previous purchase order 30 and the 40 in the second purchase together and to form a new contract. Now it's like you cancelling off the previous contract and creating a new contract for how many? 70,000 computers. Very interesting. And then sometimes the goods may not be distinct in the contract modification. Let me think of a simple example. Construction company A enters into a contract with a customer to put up a 20-storied building. So wise man sometimes changes the mind, sometimes the fool never. Even the customer is going to be wise without being otherwise. Why? He is going to change the construction, the building from 20 stories to 25 stories now, later, subsequently. How it can be done, I don't know. You have to speak to an engineer and get the advisors. Now, first and foremost, you need to go to the top and question yourself. Is it a contract modification? For that to be a contract modification, what is the requirement? There has to be some change in the quantity or in the scope. Negotiating first for 20-storied building and then changing that to 25-storied building is a contract modification. Why there's an expansion in the scope of the construction? Number of stories goes up. Contract modification. And you need to question yourself, and your question should be so intense now. Don't be stupid. You need to question now whether the goods in the contract modification are distinct. It's not the goods in the original contract, it's the goods in the modification now. So don't get confused. How do you test it? Question yourself once again. Can the customer benefit only from the second 5 stories without the customer getting the construction company to construct the first 20? That looks funny, that looks hilarious. Why? Can the customer get someone else to first construct the last 5 stories in the sky and customer to get someone else to construct the first 20 stories and to fit them together somewhere in the sky? that looks really funny. Customer cannot benefit only from the second five without the customer getting the same construction company to construct the first 20. Goods are not distinct. Where the goods are not distinct, this is not where we are heading to, and this is where we are heading to now. It is not a cancellation of the previous one and creating a new contract. It's not creating a new contract either. It is an extension of the same original previous contract. So that is how you will decide. A change in the scope, change in the quantity, change in the volume can either be completely a different contract, and this is where we are then, can be result in you cancelling the previous contract and then creating a new contract, can be sometimes extending the same previous contract. So let me go to a simple example with the calculations with you all guys. So this is what it is all about. APLC received an order from a customer on 1st January 19 to deliver 50 computers at 80,000 rupees per computer. 20 computers were delivered. On 15th October 19, the entity received another order from the same customer to deliver another 30 computers before the delivery of the balance 30 of the first order. Explain how revenue is recognized if the selling price of a computer is 75,000 in the second purchase order. Or the selling price of a computer is 60,000. It's now reduced down to 60 from 75 with a discount, and that would have been taken into account the bulk purchase in the first purchase order. Let's see how it works now. And before the calculations, you need to see where you can position yourself in the diagram. Is it a contract modification? Yes. Why? A scope change. Are the goods in the contract modification distinct? Yes. Why? The customer benefits only from the first four, only from the second 40 or the first 50 without receiving the others. More importantly, the prices of the goods in the second contract modification are distinct. Are standalone or not standalone. Now, the seller quotes 75,000 rupee price for a computer in the second purchase order, which is the market price. So the prices are standalone or not standalone? Standalone. Where the prices are standalone, just see, visualize the diagram to say where we can position ourselves. It is like you having two contracts now. First contract for 50 computers at 75, second, I made a mistake, first contract for 50 computers at 80,000 rupees, and the second contract for how many computers, 30 for 75. And also remember, I just forgot one information to be give one small information. 60 computers were delivered during the year. Right. So let's look at the first one. Now there are two contracts. Let me take the first. Now altogether 60 computers have been delivered during the year being concerned, and that would have been on first in first out basis. Like he would have first delivered the first computers 50 ordered in the first purchase order, and the balance 10 would have been from the second purchase order. So how much should be the revenue? First contract, 50 computers at 80,000. Second contract, another 10. You know how that 10 came? The total delivered during the year has been 60, out of which 50 would have been from the first and the balance 10 would have been from the second. And 10 should be at 75,000. So this is 4 million rupees. This one is 750,000 rupees. Total revenue to be recognized now, 4,750,000. 4,750,000. That's if the second contract is considered to be separately a distinct and a different contract from the first. Now, the price is 60 when the market price was 75. The price that the seller quotes to a computer for the second purchase order has not been the existing market price. This is because the seller shows the generosity towards the customer of reducing the market price from 75,000 to 60, that was because the customer has done the first bulk purchase of 50. So the second price of 60 has been dependently decided. Now, in the diagram, you will notice this to be a contract modification. Yes, why there is a scope change? Fine. Then the goods in the contract are distinct. We learned it before. Prices now are not standalone. If the prices are not standalone, it is like you cancelling of the previous contract and creating a new contract. Then, without having first and the second contracts, let me have the old contract and the new contract. Under the old contract, how many computers had been delivered? 20 were delivered. At what price? 80,000. And that was 1.6 million. So another 30 was due. Before the delivery of the balance 30 that was due, customer sent another order, and then it's like you canceling the previous order and creating a new order. For the new order, how many computers are included? You need to take it separately. 30 is still brought forward from the previous, which was already cancelled, and that was at what price? 80,000. Plus another 30 gets added. 30 gets added at 65. So put all of them together now. Now, to calculate the selling price of a computer in the new contract, you need to take everything together and shuffle. 30 at 80 and 30 at 65, put all of them together. And it's divided by 60 for you to calculate the price of a computer under the new contract. How many got delivered? Altogether, 60 got delivered, out of which 20 has been from the old contract, and then the rest has to be from the new contract, 40. Then, for you to calculate the amount of revenue to be, the amount of revenue arising out of the new contract, you need to multiply this by 40. So let's work it out. This is 13 to 80,000 should be 2.4 million plus 30,000 into 65 should be 1,950,000 divided by 16 to 40. So you should recognize another 2,900,000 total revenue, 4,500,000. So this is how the revenue recognition looks if the prices were not standalone and there was a cancellation of the previous and creating a new contract. And I just completed discussing only the five step in our discussion, five step model. This is not a comprehensive coaching of IFRS, SLFRS 15. And there are so many other areas to be looked into. And but if you are good at these small points of five steps, catching and picking up the balance part is not a good, it's not a big deal. So please, you need to rewatch these over and over again and be smarter. Why SLFRS 15 can be sometimes changing point in your life. In ABR or the previous paper, CFR, there was a question for 19 marks as far as I can remember. And there was a girl who was in the class working brilliantly well. and she got a foreign tour. When we started discussing SLFR is 15, she came back only when we finished discussing SLFR is 15. She missed SLFR is 15 completely, and she got 42 marks. She could not score from SLFR is 15. That carried 90 marks in the paper that time. If she missed out the foreign tour and stayed in the class with SLFR is 15, she would have been through by now. So that's sometimes a very critical point at the exam SLFR is 15. Remember, in your future, the most crucial three areas will be financial instrument, SLFR is 15, SLFR is 16. So thank you very much for watching SLFR is 15.